So have you ever wondered how your brain functions when it comes to expressing your emotion or having the ability to perceive a threat or making a rational decision? Hi everyone, this is Natasha Fernandes, and in video number 2 of Making Anger Your Ally, I am going to take you through a brief, detail of how your brain works when it comes to anger or expressing an emotion. And for examples that we are going to take in this video, it may not only be connected to anger because every emotion is interconnected. For example, your anger, brings in disgust, or your anger brings in a deep-seated sadness, or something triggers off. So we are going to look at it at a combination, keeping anger as your center focus. Now, when we talk about a brain, we are talking about your physiology, which is your physical reactions, and your neuropsychology, which means how your brain, your nervous system, and your thinking works in sync of identifying a trigger and then giving an anger response. Now, scientists and researchers have figured out this one small organ inside the brain, which is known as the amygdala. Now, amygdala is a seat of response of your emotions. It can bring in fear, it can trigger anger, it can motivate us to act towards that response. Now here, the way you act and the way you choose to respond is still in your control, or is still in a choice that you make whether how you are going to act of it. Now, if you say that I do not have control, I was just overwhelmed with anger, or I just acted out in this way and I did not know what happened, I can give you a reason for that. I'm not saying that you are acting out on purpose, but you are acting out due to a lack of impulse control. When does this lack of impulse control happen? Now, let me explain how the amygdala works. For example, if you are in a crowded restaurant and there are many, many tables, and it's a completely crowded restaurant, and there are a lot of hustling conversations going on in every table. There's laughter, there's loud noises, there is giggle, there is someone speaking about some past incident, and so many things together. You may not always be able to understand what's happening. And a waiter comes in with a lot of glasses to have service at the tables, and he misses something, he topples and he just drops the tray which had glasses. The tray falls on the ground, the glasses shatter completely. The entire restaurant is come into a hush. Pin drop silence because of what happened there. The waiter, he may have intense fear or, shame, disgust, or what his actions are, but everyone else has also paused. Why cannot your brain identify that this is it's only about the waiter and he will sweep off the glasses? Everyone is quiet. Why? Because your brain sometimes cannot identify what is happening really with you or someone else. The reason is when your amygdala, which is also known as hot amygdala, if it is having less of impulse control and if it keeps going off, and if you are someone who does not know when to give a reaction or when to take a step back when you're angry, because your amygdala is designed to perceive threats. Now, if we go back to, the Stone Age times, where it was all, we used to look at things from the hunter's lens, where everything was a threat and, there were animals out there to attack, but we haven't much evolved from there. That instinct is still there. And there are some, very stereotypical definitions that women are more emotional and men have more self-control is actually false. Because both of them, and sometimes men are cut out to identify threats more than women. So it's never a gender differentiation on who perceives emotions more than the other one. It's all the same. And what I'm going to get to with another example is, for example, if you're watching a scary movie at home with lights off and, you know, with creating that entire environment of for you to have a thrill of watching a horror movie, and suddenly you hear a loud noise outside. Now you definitely know your prefrontal cortex, which is your thinking brain, definitely is going to tell you there's no ghost outside. But at the same time, your amygdala has triggered a response of fear and threat in your environment. So what would you do? You will still pause the TV or whatever you're watching with, get up and go and have a look of, did something actually happen? So this is one example. Example number two is, if you're watching a sad movie, or if you're watching a movie where there's a very, very sad scene going on of someone passing away or some bad incident happening to someone, even though your thinking brain is telling you this is a movie, you or 90% of the people will have an emotional response of crying. Is that a real event happening with you? The answer is no. So imagine if you are flooded with emotions, you are not in a capacity to even identify whether that incident is really happening with you, or it is imagined, or it is just a movie playing out. Now, I'm not telling that you need to lose your compassion, but what I'm trying to tell you here is, when we are more aware, when we are more aware, we will act less out of impulse and more about a rational way of thinking. Because your amygdala will not allow your thinking brain to think much. Now, I'm going to talk about another aspect of your thinking brain. Now, this is example number four. If you have had an unpleasant experience with a school teacher, okay, where the school teacher has put you in a space of embarrassment, or scolded you or insulted you in your childhood, or have a physical abuse like slapping you or punishing you out of the whole class, that is a shameful and an embarrassed experience which must have generated anger. And it must have generated a lot of fear towards the teacher. So it is impossible for you to forget the physical description of the teacher. Maybe she had long hair, or she had short hair, she used to wear specs, or she was a very slim lady, or she was a very stout lady. Whatever that is, that entire image of that personality registers in your brain. And any time in the future, for example, if you're going to give an interview, a very important interview, and your interviewer looks quite similar to what your teacher was, and if you do not have a good impulse control, or if you are not aware of all the triggers that are happening underlying in your body, you may not have a very successful interview. Reason? The difference between real and imaginary. You know, okay, that this is not the teacher, but still the physical features creates an alarm in your body. It lets off an alarm system saying that someone vaguely similar to who I have right now in front of me gave me a very bad experience. It was unpleasant. She was unkind, or he was unkind to me. And then your emotional brain ticks off. So where are you actually present to answer the questions for your interview? You aren't. So it takes time for you to gather yourself. So as I said, you know, all of these examples lead to the fact that your anger or your emotional response is a learned behavior. It's a collection of your past memories, a collection of your past incidences that may have happened with you. And I sympathize, you know, when it comes to, you know, there are many people who have a lot of more unpleasant incidences than others. Now, we are not here to debate of, you know, you don't know how it feels and what kind of childhood I have. Rather, we are going to look at, no matter what kind of childhood you had, I have complete empathy with you, but are you willing to change that? Are you willing to change your emotional responses and act less out of impulse and more out of awareness? Act more of how you can be present with all the triggers that are happening with you. The another flip side of having the amygdala activated is that it gathers your brain and your body. Like as I said, we looked at the neuropsychological response to it, now the physical response to it, okay? It will alert your system to prepare for threat. Now, if you hear a loud noise, what happens here is like in the movie scenario that I described, what happens is that your blood will rush to your limbs, okay? Your digestion will be shut down temporarily, and your senses, that is your eye, your pupil, may expand for you to have more light in and be able to see and identify what's happening. Either your limbs, like when the blood rushes to your limbs, okay, it is either for a fight or a flight response. Can you fight it out? You can do that. Or do you need to run? Okay, so it will give you the capacity. It is actually kind of trying to say that use these things and take action towards it. But what it fails to understand, as I told you in the examples, that it is not a real event, or maybe there are other ways where you don't have to act out of anger and you can use it in identifying your triggers and trying to slow down your triggers till you have none. Now, is it possible to have zero triggers? I don't know. I don't have the answer for it because each individual is different. But can you work towards it? The answer is definitely yes. Now we know, we have learned so many things of how your brain works around anger, at least a summary, where it is not going to have a good reaction out of you. You may break out into sweat, your heart starts beating up, you may have palpitations, and you know, you have an intense change in body temperature, either you're feeling hot or you're feeling cold, and all of that, a summary, is an uneasy experience or an uneasy feeling. Now, in the next video, I will be talking about triggers and what are the myths of anger and how you can now begin to deal with it when I share tools and techniques of managing your anger and making it your ally.
Help Talks are daily health-related talks held at Health Education Library for People, Mumbai, India. For more information, visit www.healthlibrary.com. Subscribe to Help Talks channel. Be better informed about your health.